Good evening, everyone, and welcome to SocialFlight Live. I'm Jeff Simon. We have a fascinating show for you this evening. Boris Popov, founder of BRS Aerospace and inventor of the whole aircraft parachute system, is here with us. It's really going to be a fascinating evening to hear about that history and understand the current and the future life of what is going on with a whole aircraft rescue systems through parachutes. Now, before we get started, as always, a couple quick tips. Tonight's broadcast will be recorded. It will be available on SocialFlight's YouTube channel, as well as directly on socialflight.com and within the SocialFlight mobile app. All free. All you have to do is go to socialflight.com or get the mobile app for your phone and click on the videos icon. That will bring up the recording of this and all of the SocialFlight Live broadcasts. And then you can explore, because we have so many other videos on there of other webcasts and other things that have been going on. It's really a great way to learn about things. As always, you know, we created SocialFlight to support you and to support General Aviation. Our goal is to get you flying even during the pandemic. It's so important to be able to be not just current, but also proficient, and also be able to do this thing that we all love in flying to support our mental health and to keep the spirits up of everyone. And if there's anything that you can do to help support others in transporting people or supplies or anything like that, there's so many things in the news that show how important general aviation is to the rest of the world. And the last point I'll make on that is, don't forget, please, that we are a fragile community. Anything that you can do to help support your local FBO, local airport restaurant, if you are thinking of upgrading your aircraft or headsets or anything like that, then please, this is the time to do it. You may be saving someone's job. You may be making it possible for this company to survive longer to the end of all of this, when vaccines are out everywhere and we emerge stronger from the other side of all of that. So again, thank you so much for everything that all of you do. And with that, I would like to begin by bringing on Boris Popov. You know, Boris is what I would like to refer to as a modest legend in general aviation. By modest, I mean he is modest. You don't hear much from him, and yet he is legendary in what he's done for this industry. He immigrated to the United States from Munich, Germany in 1949, fell in love with aviation, and following a near-death emergency in aviation involving a hang glider, he made it his life's work to create a safe landing solution when all else fails with the aircraft. In 1981, he founded Ballistic Recovery Systems, BRS. If you look at the type certificate for the Cirrus aircraft, you'll see BRS listed as the what's known as the CAPS parachute recovery system. Today, the systems developed by BRS have saved 438 lives and sold over 35,000 systems throughout the world. BRS has 120 employees and plants in St. Paul, Minnesota, Pine Bluff, North Carolina, and Tijuana, Mexico. And among many other accolades, I'm happy to say that Boris Popov is also the 2009 winner of the Elmer Sperry Award for Distinguished Engineering. With that, I would like to bring on Boris Popov to join us here on SocialFlight Live.
Good evening, Jeff.
Hi, how are you doing, Boris?
Good. Thank you for this opportunity to discuss the history of BRS. It's quite an honor.
Well, you know, honestly, there are so many things that fascinate me about different aspects of aviation, but your story and what you have done to just plain save lives in it, I can't think of anything more important. And so tell me about how you went from being an immigrant to this country and just interested in aviation to pushing the limits and creating the first aircraft recovery parachute systems.
Well, at the risk of sounding a little bit melodramatic, which I don't want to do, but it was quite a interesting genesis for me. I started my first flight when I was about 8 years old. I decided to steal my parents' bedsheet. I went to an oak tree in the yard. I took my mother's sewing thread, tied a thread to each corner, climbed up to about 10 feet and jumped off. Imagine the impact. And I was laying there stunned, looking up at the tops of the trees in the sky, And I see my dad's head suddenly looming over me, and I'm going, I remember thinking, oh my God, am I in trouble? This is going to be a lot of punishment coming for this act. And he looked at me and gently said, son, I think you got to start a little bit higher. So that was my first so-called flight. After that, my real first airplane flight was in a classic 1950s yellow Piper Cub that my uncle flew. He was in Germany at the time, right after and before World War II. He was a sailplane pilot. When he came and immigrated here, he got into flying, got access to us to a little Piper Cub, I mean, classic yellow, you know, and took me up. I loved every minute of it until he made a radical standard rate turn to the right. And then I learned all about cleaning up cockpits, you know, sponges. So, but I remember the fantastic feeling of as a young boy and flying in this little airport that went in the middle of nowhere. And it's still there, and I still go there occasionally. But after that, I basically got into school and sports. I was a college gymnast and track enthusiast, and didn't have a lot of time to fly, but I decided to try to get my license at the University of Minnesota Flight School at Anoka County Airport, and got my solo certificate when I was 20. Then I proceeded to get my private license shortly thereafter, my ground instructor license, sailplane license, and so forth. So that was sort of the genesis of my flying career. The genesis of BRS was a little bit more complex. I started hang gliding in 1973-74, which is really early. That's the early years.
Yeah,
a lot
before or after your pilot license?
About a little bit after my pilot's license.
Okay.
Well, I had a good solid background in aviation, enough to know what not to do as much as what to do. But I had we wanted to order one hang glider, and the manufacturer said, if you buy two, you can be a dealer. So we bought two, and we were experts now. We're going to teach people how to fly. We went to a golf course and we ran up and down these, you know, really shallow hills. Could never get airborne. Finally got steeper and steeper, and finally got a foot off the ground. And honestly, to this day, I'll never ever forget that thrill of feeling yourself get lifted off the ground in a hang glider. No noise, just your own energy being used to get yourself airborne. Fantastic feeling. So that led to us being a dealer for these hang gliders. That led to us opening up a flight school. And about that point, 1977, this business of taking a hang glider behind a boat with water skis became popular. So of course I wanted to try that. So I talked to a friend of mine.
How do you start that way? You're in the water on water skis with a hang glider?
Yeah. I'm a pretty decent water skier, so I wasn't intimidated by that, but I'd never towed before. Nobody really had at that point, other than a couple of real brave pioneers in the sport. But I told them, look, if I cross my skis, slow down. If I spread my skis apart, speed up. He said he got it. So he took off. I mean, looking back, it's like you're wondering what in the world you were thinking. 500 foot of line, we take off. I get airborne, and this thing just skyrockets almost vertically. And I know this is not a good thing. Because I'm going to reach the end of this apogee and something's going to have to happen. So I signal for him to slow down. He thought I meant to speed up. So he hit the throttle of a 200 horse inboard. And I just popped straight up. The crossbar broke. And it was like the Wile E. Coyote cartoon. I literally pitched up, stopped, turned, and started spiraling down.
Oh, God.
So all the way down from 500 feet. That's a long way, 500 feet. You got a lot of time to go through a lot of emotional feelings. Acceptance, denial, anger. I went through all those phases. It was pretty fascinating. But I was also, like I said, I was a college gymnast and a pole vaulter, so I was used to falling and landing in really weird positions on, you know, hard surfaces. So I tucked up, hit the water, took a big deep breath of air to get my lungs full of air and hit the water. I came up and I literally spit out fillings. That's how hard I hit. And nothing really serious happened other than a bruised kidney. But all the way down as I was spinning, I was thinking, you dumb son of a gun, why don't you have some sort of a parachute device? why don't you have a parachute device? But I also learned another very important lesson. I was pulling so many Gs that even though hand-deployed parachutes are just beginning to get talked about, just beginning to become something that we were looking at for emergency safety systems and hang gliders, I realized that I couldn't even lift my hands off my chest. You know, the G-forces were just spinning me so hard. So I realized that, yeah, a parachute might have saved me, but how the heck are you going to get it out quickly and away from the structures of the collapsed hang glider? So that led to me promising myself, I'm going to develop some sort of a ballistically, the term ballistic is something that I coined, but that just means some sort of a rapid deployment method, whether it's a drill gun or mortar systems or rockets, what have you. So that led to the creation of BRS, and you mentioned in your introduction that was we were incorporated in 1981 as BRS, and the rest of it is pretty much the history of BRS per se.
And so but even at that point, so take me through this. So, and I'll actually, well, we'll show this some more pictures when we get actually a little closer in the development. So you say the rest is history, but the reality is at this point in time, all you've got is an idea and some teeth missing fillings.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of experience flying and one bad one hang gliding.
Mm-hmm.
How do you turn that into a company?
Well, I'm a hunter, and I'm familiar with weapons and guns, and I decided that I was going to learn the hard way about F equals MA. So I started out with a little bit of M and a lot of A. So I started out with the 38 caliber pistol round. I literally drilled a hole in the bullet and attached a cable to that and attached that to the top of the parachute and went in the back of our yard and shot it. Well, you can imagine. So we learned that
you didn't want to start with like the crossbow or something.
No, yeah, I should have gone even further back than that. It's interesting. You learn. I have a background in aeronautical engineering. I was a student at the University of Minnesota in aeronautical engineering, so I understood some physics. And F equals MA. That's it. You either have M or you have A. And so we got to bigger and bigger loads, bigger bullets basically, but I couldn't quite get to that size that I needed. And somebody from Honeywell, ironically, heard about me and literally came walking into my office one day, opened up a briefcase, and I thought I died and went to heaven. He opened up a briefcase and there was slug guns that they use for ejection seats. Huh. And I can't tell you how many thousands of hours and dollars I'd spent trying to build exactly what was sitting there in front of me in that little briefcase.
So first of all, everybody on there, FMA, force equals mass times acceleration on that, right?
Thank you.
And then what is a slug gun?
It's electronically or mechanically activated body that has a 1 pound slug that shoots out, which is exactly what I was looking for. They use them in injection seats and other applications. But so we took this thing. We had it modified and adapted. And one of my funnier stories is my office is located next to a grocery store. And we were firing this thing off in places we shouldn't. And one day it went off and it went through one of the sheetrock walls, one of our common walls of the grocery store. And about 5 minutes later, I had a knock on the door and here comes the manager of the grocery store. He says, Boris, come here. And he leads me over to the meat section and laying in the sausage section of the meat section is one of our slug guns lined up perfectly with the sausages. He says, you got to knock this stuff off. So I never forget looking up and seeing a pattern of through the sheetrock of all these holes through our common wall. He was a great guy. He just said, you got to stop this. You're going to kill somebody. So there was a lot of, you know, a lot of trial and error. We did a lot of ground testing. We realized as we got towards this, away from the hang gliders and towards the home builds and the ultralights, the home builds, and certainly towards the Cessna 150, that the recoil we were running into was going to be prohibitive. We're actually building up more weight and structure to reinforce the recoil than the weight of the system. Then we got into and discovered solid fuel rocket motors, which is what we have today, which is very little recoil, a lot of force, very little recoil. And a tunable force. You can have a time thrust curve that you can adjust really beautifully to whatever your needs are. So that really got us into the stage of where BRS is today.
Wow. And so that took you through rockets. Now that that took care of that side of it, but you obviously had to learn a lot about parachutes along the way as well.
Exactly. There's four things that BRS really, I think, is proud of and was innovative and creative that the industry wasn't doing at the time. Number one, we knew that to put a parachute on a ultralight, especially, or any lightweight airplane, it had to be lightweight. You can't have a big parachute, a big heavy mass like that. So we experimented with zero porosity parachute cloth, ripstop, which is like in tents today, that real thin 1.1 ounce per square yard, zero porosity cloth. Great stuff, a much smaller parachute, much higher drag coefficient, which is what you want. But the problem is at high speed, it's not breathing. It's not letting forces, the air to be does not get forced through the material. So it absorbs all that force and has to go somewhere. So we developed the slider, which we received a patent for. And it's an annular ring device that basically, if you look at some of the videos of the Cirrus deployments, especially, shows up very well. It's just a ring that gets slid up to the top of the parachute at the mouth, keeps the parachute closed at high speed, yet at low speed, it doesn't affect the deployment at all.
And so is that ring is something that you developed?
Yes, we were the first ones to incorporate the slider into a round parachute. They were around for sports chutes, but not for this application.
So I'm going to show, you sent a couple videos. I'm going to see what we can show right now about that. The first one is going to be this video you sent having to do with in Argentina of a RANS S7 doing an air show. Mm-hmm. And that had a structural failure during that, where you can actually see the system.
Yes, that's definitely a structural failure when you lose a wing completely off the aircraft. Yes,
you're out of options at that point. Let me do this. It'll cut off our audio while I show it, but I'm going to show this video briefly, and then we'll come back. You can tell me about that, and then we will take a look at another one, which is your emergency parachute test. So let's see what we can do here.
Tipo tractor que está tirando adelante la aeronave. Esta aeronave que tiene tren convencional. Aumentar velocidad. Ya está en los 100 y algún kilómetros por hora. Invertido. Y pasa saludando al trébol, colgando del asiento. Arriba va Diego Bolívar, en negativo. Paso. Nadie se mueva del lugar, bajamos la música.
Hemos tenido una emergencia en la aeronave. Todo el mundo queda en su lugar tranquilamente. Lo van a ir a atender. Miren qué bárbaro que estuvo lo del paracaídas balístico. Rápidamente, bomberos, por favor, atentos en caso de que haya algún incendio. Nadie ingresa al predio. Con mucha calma, todo el mundo se queda muy tranquilo en el lugar. Por favor, todo el mundo muy tranquilo en el lugar. Bomberos, ambulancias.
So, that's dramatic.
I would think that qualifies as dramatic, yes. Some people actually claim that we set that up because the footage is so great and the timing was perfect, but he's the young man, 20-year-old kid that obviously is a very good aerobatic pilot. He saw some of the movement they made there. But you also notice it came down nose first. So he didn't install the straps on perfectly right. So he ended up coming down nose first rather than in a flying position. But he walked away. And his 2 years later, I was at Oshkosh at our booth, and this little lady came up to me and just grabbed me by the waist and hugged me. I had no idea what was going on. And she looked up and said, you saved my son. And it was Dino, the kid, the pilot, that was piloting the airplane at that usage of the BRS. So it's quite an emotional and great moment for me in the history of BRS to have that happen.
I can only imagine. And the reaction time also was shocking. Yes. On that.
Yeah, it was. Well, when you see your wing leaving, I don't think you have much thing. What do you think about? There's not nothing you can do. I mean, you're not going to control this airplane back to the ground. He knew right away that when you watch that wing leave, that he has to deploy the chute. But it's a good video.
That handle must have been in a way that was easy to access for him too.
That's another really interesting discussion about where to put a handle. Like when I was telling you about my G-forces, you know, it's hard to move your arms around when you're pulling that kind of G's. But he had it right by his hip and deployed it very quickly. And it's a good video to show how quickly the system opens. It's almost an instantaneous deployment.
Wow. I'm going to show the picture. I understand some people on mobile devices were not able to see the video from the ones that have come in. But this is a looks like a snapshot.
It is of the video, yes. And you can see that slider up at the mouth of the parachute. It's sort of like a donut-shaped material. Or that's a slider pushed all the way up against the skirt of the parachute, which is keeping it from opening too rapidly. But that slider that comes down after a split second or two.
Yeah, and you can see, I guess, also you see the canopy open in this case. Is that does it deploy through the canopy in this?
No, that came through the side of the fuselage. You must have opened it.
Okay, just as like a safety precaution in there. Let's look at a couple more pictures here. When you talk about saves, this is also one that apparently was in the Bahamas.
Mm-hmm. Dick McLaughlin and his daughter were flying to Haiti for a relief mission and lost engine power, lost oil pressure, and then lost their engine, of course, halfway across the Bahamas, and deployed the chute and put it in the water and swam away. He's funny. He says the last time he saw his airplane, it was about 5 miles away, being dragged along the surface of the tortuous waters of the Bahamas. Nobody ever found the airplane again. So if anybody's in the Bahamas happens to see a Cirrus SO-22, let Dick know that you found his airplane.
So basically the chute remained open, as you can see here afterwards, and just took the plane for a ride because wow. That's pretty impressive. And then this is another small one of apparently right there on the ground during that rescue. And then here's another one of another save.
Yeah, and that was our first Cessna save. This is a man with a lot of hours. I think he said 14 or 15,000 hours. He's an aerobatic instructor. He had the Peterson STOL kit installed, and at the same weekend that they were installing that Peterson kit and doing his annual, he fortunately had the BRS installed. The mechanic had turned this fuel selector into the off position. If you know about Cessnas, it's down between the seats.
Yeah.
Well, part of his free flight, and I've flown off Cessnas, I do the same thing. I just feel for that position of that, you know, left, right, both off. But it was facing forward and back, but it was in the off position instead of on both position. So he took off, And of course, he pitched up with the STOL kit. He wanted to try it out, so he had a real high angle of attack. He got about 500 or 600 feet, started a turn, which is absolutely the worst thing that can happen. Just as he started his turn, the engine quit. So he said, and this is an aerobatic instructor, and he comes to Oshkosh, and used to come quite often with us, and talk to people, and anybody who was skeptical about what they would have done, he'll put them straight. He said, there was no time to do anything. My engine quit, I pitched and rolled over, and I was basically facing the ground going in from 500 feet. The chute was pulled at about 350 feet, which is quite low. And just as the chute opened, he hit the top of the trees and survived, obviously. So he was a very fortunate he had that parachute on when he did.
Oh my God. Yeah. Well, that's pretty impressive. Now let's take us back to some of the things that go into this again, because I know, given your history and what you've been through, obviously it can seem like this is just, you know, in a way, and this goes to how I opened with your modesty. You bring it as like, yeah, we did this, and then poof, there's an airplane shoot. But obviously there's a lot of struggles that have to go along the way with something like this. You're dealing with chutes. You're dealing with the ballistics. What's even involved with starting to work with rockets and anything like that? And then we'll talk about what's involved with when you go to the FAA and say, hey, so we want to talk to you about putting a rocket in an airplane.
You can imagine. Yes. Well, it, you know, pyrotechnics, they're a challenge. First of all, shipment. We have to ship these things all over the world, and they're classified by a UN number. It makes it difficult, not impossible, but difficult. You have to follow a lot of procedures. You have to store it in bunkers. So it's a bit ridiculous, because I can take a case of shotgun shells and keep it in my living room for, you know, or anywhere. There's no regulations on that. But a smaller amount of solid fuel rocket propellant in the igniters, it gets into all kinds of classification and things like that. But
when you were trying to imagine what this system was going to look like, I mean, so many questions come to mind. You've got, how do you contain something? How do you actually start playing with rockets and doing that? How does it not burn up everything it's trailing behind it, meaning the chute? Fill me in on some of these things for kind of layman's terms.
Well, when we went away from the drill guns and the mortars, the rocket flame is really, really interesting. You think, and when you see it in slow motion, it looks pretty impressive. But we actually took human hair and placed it in the path of the rocket exhaust, and it didn't even burn the human hair. Huh. What most people don't realize is that rocket deployments, it all happens in a quarter of a second. I mean, you pull that handle and that rocket's gone almost instantaneously. So any fumes or any kind of flames that are created are not a consideration. They don't have to be something you need to worry about to any serious extent. The thing that was challenging was the thrust time curves. You want a lot of impulse at first to get that massive, look at a Cirrus SR-22 parachute. Look at the jet chute. That's a big amount of mass. You have to suddenly lift up and accelerate and get it away from the tail and the wingtips, get it out and deployed quickly. But yet you have to have this rocket not only lift that mass initially, you have to have to continue to pull that mass out the full line stretch of the parachute. So you get into all kinds of interesting physics problems and trade-offs and the weight issues, cost. But in the end, we made the right decision. Solid fuel rocket motors, electronically activated or mechanically activated, have proven themselves to be the way to go. So we solved all those problems. And this is a lot of backyard engineering. Don't get me wrong. We had good engineers, educated engineers, but we also had farm boys that loved to fly, that came in, that were unbelievably successful, innovative, courageous. Somebody had to take that Cessna 150, Jeff, and do the first deployment, right?
Wow.
I didn't want to do it.
Did you start with things like a 150, or were you still on ultralights in the beginning?
We started with ultralights. There's a lot of videos I could have sent you of some of our ultralight tests. But the real high altitude, high speed stuff, that's where it gets tricky. because instead of flying at 40 miles an hour, you're flying at 150, you're 10,000 feet. There's a lot of challenges to deploying. And nobody could, where do you go? You don't go to a library to pick up a book on how to deploy a parachute on an airplane. You got to go out and do it yourself. And Bruce Case and Phil Cadillac and Tony Kasher and Phil Cadillac and Jeff Peltier, these guys, I'll forever be grateful for these guys for their innovative thinking, their courage to go out and do these tests. They're the ones that perform the kind of testing that was really necessary to prove the concept to be valid and prove that it's safe and it's not going to kill anybody. And we had no incidents at all. The rocket deployments went fine. They did what they were expected to do. You wanted to talk about the FAA at some point, we will, but that's a whole other issue of how to lock up airspace when you tell them you're going to deploy a parachute on an airplane at 10,000 feet. Interesting history on that. The ballistics is part of it, the chute is part of it, the pressure packing. There's no way I could sell up a parachute that was the size of a 50-gallon drum for a Cessna 150. Now, just to step back a bit, I'm not the one, and BRS is not the one that put the first parachute in an airplane. That was back in the 1920s when they had the first parachute in an airplane. But they were the size of a 50-gallon drum. And that's why it never really caught on from a...
How were those deployed? I didn't even know those existed.
Oh, they threw out a little pilot chute, which then dragged out the main chute. It took forever. But there's actually some good legacy videos about those early deployments. My hat's off to those guys. I mean, they were true pioneers in that concept. But getting that parachute out cleanly, quickly, out of an aircraft requires a lot of things to happen right. And a lot of that's the technology that BRS developed. Aside from not being the first ones to put on an airplane, we did become the ones that pressure packed. When you put a 20,000 pound load on a massive nylon, nobody could tell us, did we go to 30,000 pounds? Did we go to 40,000 pounds? So we went to 40,000 pounds one day. We lifted up the foot off the pressure packer, and we had a melted block of nylon, literally melted block of nylon.
Oh my God.
So in our brilliance, you said, that's too much. We need to back off a little bit. So you play with these numbers and you get to that optimum pressure packing, that optimum type of material, the optimal thrust time force curves in the rocket motors. So there's a lot of synergy of different physics going on that makes this thing a nice, compact, unobtrusive, lightweight, effective at high speeds, low speeds, and at low altitudes and high altitudes.
So let's split this into a couple different areas, because when you think about the development side alone, right, the experimental side of what you're doing to develop a product, you mentioned like getting airspace requirements. I assume that's like a COA, an area that you can get from the FAA of restricted airspace to do certain operations. When I was in the unmanned business, that we used to get those. Is that basically what you did to get enough space to start doing kind of crazy testing?
It would have been easy if we had that option. They had no idea. Let me step back about that. The FAA, I thought, was going to be a big hindrance to this project. They, in fact, were our biggest supporters. And I can't thank enough of the local FAA people for having an open mind and saying, you know what, it's crazy, but it makes sense. Let us help you. So the FAA was really instrumental in helping BRS succeed. And it wasn't a classic bureaucratic hesitancy to do something new. These people basically said, go out and do it. Don't hurt yourself. Don't hurt anybody on the ground. You tell us what you need to have done. So they dedicated airspace for us. They allowed us to do things to the aircraft that were unusual. And never once did we run into any kind of negative input that hurt us in the development of program. Mm-hmm. So again, my hat's off to the FAA, which you don't hear a lot.
No,
but I
But when you move from the experimental side, which it sounds like they were wonderful about, and you start breaking new ground, as we're seeing with electric aircraft, as we've seen with so many other things, when there's no regulations in existence to support the new technology you're looking to then certify, mm-hmm. how do you approach that?
You know, it's the same thing. They basically said, you guys develop the regulations, you write the TSOs, you write the conditions for testing, you present us a compliance plan. And we did. We wrote the compliance testing that we thought was fair, and we were being fair to ourselves and to them. And they basically signed off on us and let us do what we thought was the appropriate way to do it and the safe way to do it. Mm. So I don't have to expand on it because it was really nothing there that created any kind of controversy or any kind of resistance that hurt BRS's development.
That's great. So then take me through, obviously the Cirrus was the first real mainstream OEM aircraft that included your system. Tell me a little bit about that. What's the story of that?
Alan and Dale and I hadn't met at that point when we first had the Cessna 150 certified. But what I didn't know was that they were watching us. As you know, Alan's story about his mid-air collision, and he was a believer in the concept before we knew Alan. And when we got the Cessna certified, he basically said that we want the system on an airplane. And he approached me with a phone call. It's another interesting little tidbit. I got a call from some kid in Baraboo, Wisconsin, that wanted to put a parachute in this new hot airplane he was building. Well, you can imagine how many of those we get in a year, hundreds of calls like that. And I almost didn't call him back, but thank goodness that I did. And I called Alan back, and we had a nice conversation, and he basically said, let's talk. And he told me about his plan with the VK, and of course, I graduated into the SR series. But Alan and I had lunch with Dale. Dale and Alan and I had lunch up in Duluth. He handed me a check. He said, here you go. Go for it. Do it. Develop a parachute for us. It was that simple. Just do it.
Wow.
And again, they're innovative, courageous thinking and outside the box. They realized that this is going to be a great aspect of their airplane. Alan was really thinking ahead of most people when it came to that. And so was Dale. They both supported the idea. So it led from there to the SR-20 system, the SR-22 system. We had a great relationship. There was a lot of dynamics involved with the Chinese buying the company and a lot of the vendor supplier issues that come up with any relationship. But thank God for Cirrus, because they validated in the best way possible the concept of and the validity of putting a parachute on an airplane. You can imagine, Jeffrey, the skepticism that we ran into from the legacy manufacturers and that they ran into. I mean,
yeah.
Why do you need a parachute on a perfectly good airplane? But let me tell you a statistic that I always bring up because it's stunning to me when I did the math on this. One out of 120 chutes that we've sold has been deployed.
Wow.
One out of 120. And when that's I did the math, huge. I thought I'd have my decimal place in the wrong spot. Now, this is guys flying, you know, recreational F-16 pilots on their time off deploying chutes. This is high-time aerobatic pilots. This is commercial pilots. This is the person that shouldn't be riding a bicycle, much less flying an airplane. It crosses all lines of experience levels and types of aircraft, certified, non-certified, home builds, services. So it's from a statistical standpoint, it covers the spectrum of capabilities and airplane types, one out of 120.
Wow.
And if you took 120 people with BRSs and put them in a room and said, one of you is going to deploy a chute every year, think of that. That's the number. So it's a number I don't like to push real hard because it shows you that small airplane flying has its risks and we need to face that reality. And with the BRS system on board, you can mitigate that risk significantly.
Right. Right. Yeah. It's I hadn't heard that number before. I'd certainly, of course, familiar with your 438 lives saved, but to have, you know, one out of 100 chutes sold be used, and understanding, of course, that is also, and like you said, in all facets, that doesn't mean that that's what's happening in Cirrus's. Right. That's a pretty impressive number.
It is. It's a stunning number, and like I said, I thought I had my decimal place in the wrong spot when I first did it. That's the
number. Now, was it challenging in I know you're working directly with Cirrus to get the first SR series, the SR20, certified with a chute. There's competitors at the same time. You've got Lancair doing things. At what point, what role do you think adding a chute to an aircraft plays in its certification? How challenging is it when someone comes up and decides, okay, it's going to take me X amount of time to certify an airplane normally, and if I'm going to put a chute on it, how much harder is that? I know you can't quantify it specifically, but just how much harder is it to do that?
You know, it from a mechanical standpoint, it's no harder, no easier to do an installation on any aircraft. It's just geometry. Mm-hmm. Bigger chute, bigger package, bigger, larger weight. The certification process obviously becomes a whole different ballgame, right? Mm-hmm. That's getting the STCs and getting the certification for the VLA or for the LSAs. They all demand certain tests be done and certain criteria that be performed. But it really is nothing that we found to be oppressive to the point that it hurt us in our capabilities of making the systems for anybody certified or uncertified.
I think a lot of people, if we talk about like viewers out there, you know, the average pilot that's out there right now, when we think about aircraft that have it and aircraft that don't, there's that question that has to be the question that comes to mind of is it just that it's that much harder to certify it that keeps these other airplanes to do it? Is it a mental state of, I just don't believe in it, and I'm not gonna go that way? Is it cost? Like, and I'm sure there's a factor of everything, but yeah, I can understand legacy, you know, mm-hmm. Why aren't we seeing these on Cessnas, Bonanzas, the Pipers? Like, why aren't these out there in the regular OEM fleet? Why is it only Cirrus that's known for it? And then is it a staple among the young innovative LSA companies? It seems they also go both directions as well.
Yeah, that's a great question, and it's a delicate answer.
I'm sure it is. I didn't ask it for no reason.
There is a lot of I shouldn't say there's a lot. There's a lot less skepticism than there ever was before, but there's still this attitude of, on some manufacturer's part, that if I admit that I need to put a parachute or offer a parachute on my airplane, there's something wrong with my airplane. It's nonsense.
That's still a philosophy.
It's still there. It's still there, but a lot less than it used to be. We've had negotiations and discussions with a lot of legacy manufacturers, all of them, and it always seemed to come down to, do they want to allocate funds to a very small segment of their product line, or, you know, focus more on the business jets? And, you know where I'm going with this.
It was just never
seemed to be a high enough income producer to make a better single engine airplane with or without a chute. Even though they did produce some very interesting competitors, potential competitors of Cirrus, it never really caught on that it was worth the gamble and the expense of offering the parachute as an option or even a standard equipment.
So, Dale had an interesting way of looking at it when he described on the show, when he was a guest here, about the development of the Cirrus, of the SR series. I mean, he was very open that, like, this was essentially designed for the passenger first. Yes. And foremost as the priority. And when you design for the passenger, you're thinking the priorities change instead of how fast can you get there? What's your exact useful load? It's what mm-hmm. the comfort level is. How comfortable is the cabin? What's the perceived safety? What happens if something happens to the pilot? And mm-hmm. It seems like there's starting to be a change in the market a little bit to pay more attention to that. And now you have things with, you know, Autoland with Garmin and different brandings of that with the different companies that are using that. But it doesn't, I hope that this does not turn out to be something that has to be one way or another philosophically. It would seem that if the aircraft can easily be flying, well, then by all means, you know, use an autopilot that can take you all the way to the ground if the problem's with the pilot. But if the problem's with something else, you have another option with BRS and a chute.
I always say that we're human beings flying a mechanical device. One or the other is eventually going to fail, period. There's no exceptions to that rule. So we even had an Air Force pilot officer send us a letter one day that said, you know, what you're doing is horrible. We're going to have people flying in the patterns, deploying chutes and getting in my way. It's a stupid idea. You
know, you need blowing up chutes and getting in my way. I like that.
I framed that letter from this Air Force major because it was, to me, just profoundly ridiculous. But that was the old days. And now to answer your question, we deal with a lot of manufacturers, especially the new upcoming manufacturers, and there is hardly anybody out there who's not at least looking at the option now of offering a parachute either as standard or as an option. They're all now saying it ain't a bad thing. It's probably a good thing. Mm-hmm. But Jeffrey, it's been almost 40 years since we started fighting that battle. It shouldn't have taken 40 years to convince people that it's just another option for you. If you don't believe in it, take out your second magneto, take out your shoulder harness, take out your seat belts. What do you need all that stuff for if you're never going to need to have any kind of safety devices on board? It's just another option for you. And again, Cirrus has proven the point that there's been enough articles written that have investigated the real net effect of what is the CAP system, what has the BRS system done for the safety numbers. And it's indisputable. It has saved a lot of lives. Yeah. I mean, if you think about 438 people, pilots, you think about the ramifications of that. The surgeon, the doctors that could have not gone on and continued to save lives in their professions, the family, the suffering. That's a lot of people. You put that in a room and you say, this is the number of people we've saved. It's pretty.
Yeah. And even when you put the business hat on, though, I mean, you go back in time. You had Cirrus and Columbia, essentially, from Lancair. There are a lot of differences between those aircraft. They were managed differently. There's a lot of other things you could throw out there. But there was one glaring difference between those two aircraft, and it was your chute.
That's right.
And one of them won and is right now kicking pretty much everybody else's butt in shipments per month.
Sure.
And they all come with chutes. So maybe that's hopefully a lesson for some of the other aircraft that are out there.
I think it is. I don't think anybody can dispute the fact that Cirrus is a great airplane, but the chute in combination with an airplane like that is going to be a market leader for decades to come.
Right. There's a business case. We always have to make a business case to all these companies, and hopefully the business case, it's not just safety. It's people buying it because of safety, even if it's perceived at that point. So tell me a little bit about what everybody thinks Cirrus when we talk about chutes, but there's a lot more than Cirrus. So tell me today, if someone's going out, if they own an aircraft, an older aircraft, tell me what the fleet entails, your products, roughly kind of what it costs to put something like this in, and who it's there for. Because I think one of the huge opportunities out there for safety is so many people with legacy aircraft that could be adding these to their aircraft.
We have over 340 different aircraft installation designs. So we cover a lot of different aircraft models. Our obvious push is the Cessna 172, the 182. That's become very successful for us. That is a fairly straightforward process. The cost is minimal. The installation is moderate. It takes about 35, 40 hours of installation time. It can be done by any qualified A&P. We have installation centers around the world for putting these systems in the Cessna aircraft.
So 35, only let's say 40 hours of work. So that's like a 1 week of work to put a BRS system into a 172?
Yes.
And roughly what's something like that cost aside from that at 40 hours of installation?
It's around $17,000, $15,000 to $17,000 for 172, 182 in that price bracket. But
less than a GPS navigator.
It's basically. Well, yeah, that's what we argue. That's what we argue. Yeah, for sure. So it's not a big expense when you look at the avionics, the cost of avionics and other attachments to the airplane. So
and how much weight?
It's about 45, 50 pounds, depends on the model, which airplane you're talking about. Cirrus is about 70 pounds. So it's not a lot of weight. And that we actually have an SDC addendum that can give you a more usable weight. It actually decreases your penalty of having the BRS on board and actually gives you useful load. So that's nice little attribute to have on this airplane.
So I can help negate some of the 40, 50 pounds or something like
right.
that.
Right. So, and it's in any typical home built ultralight experimental, we can put a parachute on it. It just comes down to your maximum gross weight and your VNE speeds.
Well, let's literally list for everyone, not the 350, but what the big ones are from the most of the audience, right? I mean, you mentioned 172, 152, because you talked about that in the beginning, 150, 152. What other ones on the average airport that you're going to see big numbers of should people hear we've got a shoot for you?
Well, RVs are one of our more popular ones as well. There's a lot of RVs flying out there. We have it for the 7 and the 9 and other models that are coming into play here as well. There's, of course, the CT line of aircraft. That's a very popular one. That comes with standard equipment on the CT lines. It's been a half an hour.
I'm thinking mainly the certified guys that are out there. Do they go in Pipers? Do they go in Beechcraft?
Well, the only certified we have right now is the 170, 150, 152, 172, 182.
And okay. Are you looking at expanding that?
We are. We get a lot of questions and a lot of inquiries for the 206, even up to the 208s, the Caravans, the 210s. So there's, you know, they all take time and money. Mm-hmm. And it's just a matter of prioritizing which model airplane we're going to do next. Right. We'd like to have the FAA give us a little bit more leeway in beating compliance issues about testing for a lot of these models. Because a 182 versus a 206, yeah, it's a bigger airplane, a little bit faster airplane, a little bit more useful load. But is it really different when it comes to the parachute?
Right.
Not
really, right.
Just geometry. But that's a little bit of a hurdle that we're trying to work through, and the FAA is working with us on that to try to minimize the expense and the time to certify these newer models that we're working on. But yeah, next line would be the 206.
Probably. Okay, it'd be great. I'll tell you to see you break into both the Piper and Beechcraft line as well.
Yes, we've talked about the Archer and the there's a lot of people waiting for that to come on as well. But we need the manufacturer's cooperation. When you're dealing with a certified airplane like that, like Piper Archer, you need the factory to work with you. And that requires a lot of effort and a lot of expenditure on our part. So we'll get there.
Yeah, that's tough. It's not something you can do as just an aftermarket STC on your own without the engineering data that goes around that airframe. So is that really the challenge, is understanding engineering data?
Yeah, you know that game as well as anybody does, right?
I might. So what's next for BRS, Boris?
You know, the VTOL market is something we're really focused on. This autonomous flight, autonomous air freight delivery, really interesting stuff. VTOL presents another challenge, as you can imagine. The V is vertical takeoff, right? And that means low and slow on takeoff and landing. So it requires a real generational leap in parachute technology. You got one thing going against you. You got a parachute that's going to bring down a 2,000 pound VTOL. It has to be so long, 50, 70 feet long of suspension lines and bridle and parachute cloth. You can't open a parachute until it gets stretched out. And there's ways of developing a rapidly opening canopy. But it's still a limiting factor, is the fact that you have low airspeed. You know, you need to give me either airspeed or give me altitude. Give me one or the other. when you don't give me either one of them, it's a real challenge. But we have some really exciting and ingenious solutions for these VTOLs that I think is going to make significant impact on the safety of these VTOLs.
You would think that would have a lot of attention out there, because with so much attention on this idea of, you know, VTOL and having all these different kind of people movers start taking up airspace and dealing with congested traffic and doing all this point to point. Like you said, there's a lot of risk there, and there's a lot of attention on that risk from non-pilots and people who don't think of themselves in the future as getting on an airplane. They figure they're getting on a new kind of Uber that's just going to jetson them around the city. And I think there is going to be a huge demand on safety systems for that. So I think you're pretty well poised for that.
We are, and they're aware of it. Most of these new manufacturers, who are well funded, by the way, amazingly well funded, they know damn well that they can't have these things flying around congested airspace and losing engines, losing control for whatever happens, and coming down in the schoolyard. That can't happen. The public won't tolerate that. Neither will the government agencies. There has to be some sort of recovery device on all these VTOLs, and it's an exciting market. It's one that we're deeply involved with on all kinds of levels, in all kinds of countries around the world. A lot of fun stuff, a lot of really creative, crazy, wonderful ideas out there that people ask me, why are you still working at BRS? And, you know, and I say, because I love it. It's just, there's so many wonderful risk-taking people out there trying these concepts on VTOL some of them are going to succeed, and of course some of them won't. But yeah, it's a big market for BRS, big potential, and we're well poised to pay a big part of it.
Excellent. Well, Boris, thank you so much for taking the time to join us this evening on Social Flight Live again, and thank you for everything that you've done and the lives that you've saved in our industry. It really my hat is off to you, both for that and for the things you've done to prop up the industry by helping create things like what the success of Cirrus through having that shoot. It lifts all of us up, and I wish you the best in extending your line of what you do for both certified and experimental aircraft, and then of course in this new revolution that eventually will be coming to a city near you, and we'll see if a BRS logo is going to be attached to an awful lot of those VTOL aircraft.
I'm sure it will. Thank you for those kind words, Jeff, and thank you for the opportunity for this discussion.
Absolutely. And to all of you out there, again, thanks so much for taking the time to join us this evening on Social Flight Live. As always, we are here every Tuesday evening at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. We have some great shows coming up as well, so be sure to stay tuned. Tuesday, January 19th at 8 p.m., we have Elliot Seguin, test pilot extraordinaire, worked with Burt Rutan's Scaled Composites. And so if you want to hear about test flying with Burt Rutan at Scaled Composites, be sure to tune into that show. There might be a couple stories that come along with it. On the 26th, Tuesday the 26th, Ariel Tweedo of Flying Wild Alaska will be here on the show. And on February 2nd, Mike Bush is back. I think we're going to be talking about ignition systems and many, many more things to come. Until next time, again, thank you, Boris. Thank you, everyone, for taking the time out of your evening to join us. And I wish you all blue skies.